News from the Northeast is here in half an hour. First, the latest from ITN.
From ITN, News at 10, with Julia Somerville.
The Clinton smile that says it's in the bag. Widowed by a firework, a bonfire night warning. A confession in public, Gascoigne admits his shame. And if you can't get to the concert, get the concert to come to you. Good evening. Americans will vote tomorrow for the man they want to be their first president of the 21st century. And it's odds on it'll be Bill Clinton. Despite a frantic 4 days of campaigning, the Republican candidate Bob Dole shows no sign of closing the gap. Tonight, both camps are claiming they can win, but few believe it'll be Mr. Dole. As America prepares to vote, ITN correspondents are with both teams. And first we go over live to Bill Neely, who's with the president.
Well, here in Cleveland, Ohio, is all the proof you need of Bill Clinton's strength tonight. He has been campaigning passionately to tens of thousands in a state which has seen some hard times and which often votes Republican, but which this time is booming and voting to re-elect the president.
The final day of his final campaign, Bill Clinton easily ahead in the polls, but not easing up.
Will you seize the day tomorrow to do that?
Traveling to seven states in a day, urging Americans not to take his re-election for granted. Only the biggest upset in American political history can deny him now. Mr. Clinton, as always, reluctant to predict anything.
Mr. President, are you confident?
His running mate, less reticent.
Are you confident, Mr. Vice President?
We feel good about it. We've got more than 24 hours left.
Turnout's the key, yes?
Right.
There's a lot of life left in this old dog.
He began the day with tears in his eyes, where he began his rise to the presidency 5 years ago in New Hampshire.
Are you running for something?
Selling himself and his record relentlessly, out-campaigning Bob Dole even now with his words and his ways.
I have been more blessed than any American in my lifetime.
He has been blessed with a strong economy, the country is at peace, and its people contented.
And you have to decide.
They did decide months ago. This race never tightened, it settled in the spring. And tonight, in the chill of America's autumn, Bill Clinton leads in every region, in most states, even in places he's never won before. It is all over, bar the voting. Bill Neely, News at 10, Cleveland, Ohio.
The Bob Dole 96 Hours to Victory Tour has now arrived here in Houston, Texas. There are just 20 hours to go, but victory still seems as far away as ever. Exhausted he may be, but Bob Dole will battle on to the end. Not so much because he still expects to win this race, but because he must now try to save the Republican majorities on both the House of Representatives and the United States Senate.
They're here, yeah!
In 3 days, he has passed through 12 states and more than 20 cities, drawing enthusiastic crowds, but having almost no effect on his standing in the polls. He is not admitting defeat, but when he warns of the danger of giving the Democrats a majority in Congress, it doesn't sound as if he expects to be president.
Think back what happened in the first 2 years when they had a Democratic Congress and Bill Clinton as president. Now, you got the biggest tax increase in the history of the United States of America.
Win or lose, he is defying those critics who said he was too old at 73 to run for the White House. His resilience on this final tour has astonished those traveling with him, stopping to address small crowds in all-night diners, still looking fresh and robust for the set-piece rallies with which he starts each day. And still, the big issue is trust.
I may not keep my voice, but I'll keep my word. I'll keep my word.
Former President George Bush is alongside Bob Dole throughout these last campaign stops. This is the end for his political generation. The last of those leaders who knew World War II is passing from the scene. James Mates, News at 10, with the Dole campaign.
There were calls today for tighter restrictions on imported fireworks following the weekend deaths of two people. Campaigners claim a change in the law 3 years ago has meant thousands of potentially lethal fireworks are now being sold. The family of one of those killed today urged everyone to take extra care at bonfire parties. Caroline Kerr reports.
This evening, David Hattersley's widow and his six children paid tribute to a loving father and a wonderful husband. They recalled how the school headmaster had loved organising firework displays. Now they say they hope his death will not have been in vain.
I think it is going to make people think much more carefully about the use of fireworks, and we don't really want to get into that issue. But, it's our family tragedy. But, I think it will.
The man who sold the fireworks to Mr. Hattersley's school is a retired vicar. He's been questioned by the health and safety executive, but stands by the goods he sells.
We can't obviously be responsible for, say, an accident or indeed what could be a misuse in some cases of a firework.
It was a similar sort of firework which killed a second man over the weekend. In both cases, experts say a faulty safety fuse may have been responsible. This firework conforms to the British standard. The instructions are clearly marked on the label, but perhaps its most important feature is its safety fuse. You use a safety lighter to light it, but once lit, the safety fuse comes into its own. It allows you a good 9 seconds to clear out of the way before the firework goes off. But a mortar like this can blow up in your face. A professional operator showed us what happens when the safety fuse doesn't work. Fireworks are inherently dangerous explosives, and no supplier can guarantee 100% safety. But the number of injuries is increasing. Legitimate suppliers blame a change in the law on import licenses 3 years ago.
The removal of import controls meant that anybody can now go to firework suppliers abroad and bring back anything they like here, and if they are unscrupulous, put those fireworks on the market without testing them to the British standard BS7114.
In the space of 3 years since the change in the law, the number of firework injuries has doubled. Tonight, all around the country, people are flocking to firework displays. But even the industry itself is calling for tighter regulations to ensure there's no repetition of this weekend's tragedies. Caroline Kerr, News at 10.
The troubled Tory MP Sir Nicholas Scott failed to win the backing of his local party tonight. The executive committee of the Kensington and Chelsea Conservative Association decided it couldn't support a vote of confidence in their MP. They did agree to let him put his case to a meeting of all constituency members. Here's our political editor, Michael Brunson.
Sir Nicholas Scott, though resolutely silent as he left the meeting, was clearly an unhappy man. Although he may still win through at a meeting of the full local membership, as Sir George Gardiner did at Reigate recently, Sir Nicholas's chances are not good. He was, after all, only narrowly backed for the seat after recent boundary changes, and his discovery face downwards on a pavement at the recent Tory conference followed a court appearance in March when he was fined for drink driving and banned. Members of the 120-strong executive had been told not to discuss the meeting, and most would not, though at least two of those present appeared to think that things had gone the right way.
I'm very glad what's happened.
You're glad?
Yeah.
What was the disappointment in tonight's decision?
It was a democratic decision.
Sir Nicholas's only hope now appears to be the full meeting he asked for, and which his chairman will now organise.
I have agreed to his request, and accordingly, notices convening such a meeting will be dispatched from this office this week.
For the Prime Minister promoting charity cards, high-profile turmoil involving a former minister is the last thing he needs as he seeks to steady the government during the countdown to the general election. But Tony Blair's now seen another part of the jigsaw that his pre-election strategy slot into place. The two-thirds of the party membership which voted overwhelmingly endorsed his draft manifesto. Mr. Blair had to admit that even though two by-elections may wipe out the government's majority by the new year, they may, with Ulster Unionist help, still hang on.
It is frustrating because, you know, there isn't any direction in government. I mean, decisions are made one day, change the next. It is weak. The result of that is that the country gets damaged.
But the Tories claimed that only a recent exercise in telephonic arm-twisting, led by Mr. Blair himself, had produced such a result.
Day after day on the telephone, you must vote for this or else. It reminds one of the sort of activity that used to be associated with Albanian plebiscites.
And what, asked the Liberal Democrats, was the point of it all anyway?
This is a document which wasn't even seriously debated or amended.
and certainly doesn't tell us what Labour's policy actually is in crucial areas.
Tomorrow, at a special cabinet meeting, work begins on the final stages of the public spending round. And in two key areas where the government will wish to avoid any elephant traps come the general election, it's a differing story. On education, Mrs. Shepherd has settled, a modest compromise, I'm told. But on health, Mr. Dorrell, who believes that still more cash is required, has not. Michael Brunson, News at 10, Westminster.
Two former Conservative Home Secretaries joined the criticism of Michael Howard's new crime bill today. Kenneth Baker told the Commons that mandatory life sentences for repeat violent offenders could be ineffective and potentially dangerous. He said rapists might be more likely to kill their victims as well. Douglas Hurd said there should be more emphasis on the rehabilitation of offenders. Otherwise, he warned it could lead to jails turning out more accomplished criminals. Tutsi rebels in eastern Zaire declared a unilateral ceasefire today in an attempt to help aid agencies tackle the mounting refugee crisis. They say the ceasefire will last 3 weeks unless they're attacked by government troops. The human tragedy is now centered around the border town of Goma. Refugees there are mostly Hutus, crammed into camps to the north of the town. They'd fled from Tutsi forces inside Rwanda and until today had been under attack from the north by Tutsi rebels based in Zaire itself. Our correspondent Robert Moore was the only television reporter to reach Goma today.
We were taken across the border from Rwanda and into Zaire late tonight, a city abandoned by all Westerners. There are no aid workers left, no help for the 1 million refugees in the camps a few miles from here. The only soldiers we saw were rebels, hiding in the darkened corners of Goma. This city is cut off from the rest of the world. The only hope is to create humanitarian corridors through Goma and to the refugees in the camps beyond. The rebel commander in the city appeared at ease, but he confirmed his Tutsi rebel troops have not dared to enter the refugee camps, saying his soldiers are still being ambushed. Here in Goma itself, the city appears completely abandoned, with signs of looting and violence everywhere. The camps themselves are completely inaccessible, though there are reports tonight of sporadic fighting. Earlier in the day, rebel commanders declared a unilateral ceasefire, providing the Western aid workers with their first ray of hope. There is deep concern that within the next few days, the camps with no food and little water will be the scene of a humanitarian catastrophe. Hundreds of thousands of refugees are still on the move, caught up in the fighting. Robert Moore, News at 10, inside Goma, in Zaire.
Coming up, more of today's top stories, including Gascoigne speaks frankly and says sorry to his wife.
I am getting counsel. Obviously, what happened with my wife, I deeply regret, and that will live with me forever.
5 months after the IRA's Manchester bomb, the plans to put the heart back into the city. And taking the music to the people, that authentic concert hall sound in your living room.
There now follows an announcement for Sainsbury's reward card holders. You're not going to believe this. These three jars of Nescafe used to earn 10 Sainsbury's reward points. Now they earn 300. 330 on these two packs of Pampers. From now on, as well as giving one reward point for every pound you spend, Sainsbury's are saying an extra thank you with extra reward points on over 200 everyday items. And you can get your vouchers there and then at the checkout.
Buy it, Chuck. That's fantastic.
Yes. Sainsbury's reward card, now with even more point to it.
Who's going to tell the cows?
Go on, you tell the cows.
Well?
Haven't you heard? Ansel has spread something straight from the fridge, and everyone knows you can't spread butter straight from the fridge.
Anchor make pure butter that spreads straight from the fridge. Mild and creamy, Anchor Reserve spreadable butter.
You've heard about a contract up for grabs. You need information now. What do you do?
All we know is the code RZH. It's potentially huge.
Huge is what we need right now.
Yeah, yeah. Brain trees are already in there.
Not again.
Okay, so first thing Monday morning, we get in the RZH annual report, their literature...
Jan, there's not that kind of time.
RZH, automotive parts, Sheffield. Annual turnover, 15 million, 100 employees.
The internet.
Net, of course.
The fishing guys.
So what kind of place are we talking about? Is it offices, warehouses?
I don't know, yes. I've only just
first,
pulled it off.
First, we need a way in.
I think I've just found one. I was on a training course with him.
The internet can give your business a competitive edge. Let BT show you how. Call BT Business Connections on free phone 0800 800 800.
Barclays Editions, the new current account that gives you more. Free phone 0800 00 10 11.
AA patrols fix more cars than anyone else. Join this winter. Call free on 0800 444 999.
Non piangrai farfallone amoroso, notte giorno d'intorno girando, delle belle provando il riposo, narcisetta doncino d'amor. Delle belle provando il riposo, narcisetta doncino d'amor.
Gascoigne admitted beating his wife today and spoke publicly about the rage that grips him. The England soccer star said he understood why women's rights campaigners were opposed to his selection in the latest squad, but he said he was now having counselling and deeply regretted what he had done. Our sports correspondent Graham Miller reports.
A bruise on her right cheek still visible, Cheryl Gascoigne was saying little tonight. This was the accusation, and for the first time today, Paul Gascoigne confessed he did it. His problem, he says, is a violent temper, a rage inside him that takes control.
I can't really describe the rage inside of us because I am getting counselling. I'm getting counselling of two types of people. One is personal and one is with my wife. Obviously, what happened with my wife, I deeply regret, and that will live with me forever. You know, I don't blame the likes of the women's rights. I don't blame anybody for wanting me kicked out of the squad. You know, they have their right to say something, and I, like you say, I have to live with that as well. Well, I did. I couldn't believe that was me the following morning. And so I thought, well, I definitely got this sorted out.
The counselling is already working, he says, but it's all come as something of a surprise to his wife.
I didn't know he was coming in.
But as Gascoigne trained for England's World Cup match at the weekend, women's groups were insisting counselling without punishment isn't enough.
I think it's far too soon for Gascoigne to be given rewards when he's admitted that he is a wife beater. And until we see a long time passing where he doesn't commit any further acts of violence, then I do think that he needs to be removed from the team and given the message that he will lose his livelihood and his reputation if he continues with this behaviour.
By picking him in the squad doesn't send a message out that I'm backing wife beaters. It doesn't send a message out that I condone everything that he's done.
Gascoigne's problems are far from over, but as he's now admitted, this is his last chance to put things right, both on and off the football pitch. Graham Miller, News at 10.
Seven men today admitted their part in a plot to steal hundreds of millions of pounds from bank cash machines. Southwark Crown Court heard how they planned to access the codes of customers' cards by downloading the information onto their own computers. The prosecution said it could have brought down the entire banking system. Here's our crime correspondent Harry Smith.
It would have been one of the biggest crimes in history. Hundreds of millions of pounds stolen from cash machines in Britain and around the world. The elaborate plan involved recording confidential information from cash machines. PIN numbers and other details used to extract cash are passed down telephone lines from the cash dispenser to the main bank computer. The gang hoped to infiltrate a telephone exchange and tap into these lines, recording the details on a computer at the gang's headquarters. This confidential information would be used to make bogus cards. The plan began to go wrong when one of the gang members confessed all to a prison chaplain. Martin Grant, who'd been recruited while in prison, where he was studying for a degree in electronic communications, claimed that he was being sucked into the plot against his will. In a 300-page statement to the police, he gave all the details of the plans. Police raided the home of one of the gang members and caught them red-handed, with computers, details of tens of thousands of bank accounts, and the equipment to make the bogus credit cards.
Kenneth Noy, thought to have left the country after being named as the man wanted for the M25 road rage murder, was closely associated with one of the gang members. At Southwark Crown Court, all seven men admitted conspiracy to steal from banks and building societies. They'll be sentenced next month. Harry Smith, News at 10.
A Moscow radio station reported tonight that President Yeltsin will finally have his heart bypass operation tomorrow. Doctors treating the ailing president said he was now in optimal condition to allow the operation to go ahead with maximum safety. A Palestinian woman, Nadia Zekra, who's on trial for conspiring to blow up the Israeli embassy in London 2 years ago, is to be discharged tomorrow. An Old Bailey judge said the evidence against her was fraught with pitfalls. And BT shareholders received a double bonus today. They're to get a special dividend of 30 pence a share following the announcement of the merger with the American company MCI. And their shares jumped 22 pence each after the news. It's barely 5 months since Manchester city centre was devastated by an IRA bomb. Yet tomorrow, the winning design to redevelop the entire area will be announced. Five teams of architects have been working flat out to produce plans to regenerate the 59-acre site. Their brief is to provide much more than new shops and offices. Homes, transport and green spaces must be included, and all the teams have consulted the public in an effort to avoid the development mistakes of the 60s. Vernon Mann has our special report.
A jury of planners, architects and councillors convene in Manchester to decide the course of the biggest city centre development project since the war.
A very important day for Manchester, I think.
Sir Alan Cockshaw, president of Manchester Millennium, briefs the judges who have to decide the future shape of one of Britain's biggest cities.
Okay. If you agree, what I'd like to suggest is that we ask our experts to take us through the five proposals.
So barely 20 weeks since the heart of the city and its Arndale shopping centre were devastated by a massive IRA bomb, the City Council will tomorrow unveil its chosen redevelopment scheme, a unique chance to rebuild an inner city, starting with a clean slate. One jury member is Joe Berridge, who's worked on urban planning in Britain, Canada and America.
This is big. This is big. I can't think of another city that's had to do this, which basically had its heart stopped. Right the center of town, taken out of commission. And it's an extraordinary opportunity. I mean, it came about in a terrible way, but boy, is the opportunity ever being seized. And I think one's going to be very happy with the outcome.
And it's not just the bomb-damaged city center which will be developed, though that's the first priority, but 59 acres of Greater Manchester, giving planners the opportunity to revitalize the city with an integrated transport system, green spaces, entertainments, all the things that keep people in a city. The Arndale Centre will be retained and refurbished. Amongst other ideas, a distinctive tower to be used as a high-tech information base. A big park next to the Arndale Centre. An open-air theatre north of the cathedral. And development of the riverside area into flats and amenities.
The first phase for the Arndale is to take the old bus station and redevelop that.
Manchester architect Jim Chapman explains the thinking behind his plans for his city.
We've got a great historical past and we can build on that, but I think we have to look forward and we have to look at the way the cities are going to work in the next century, and this is the challenge that we've been given.
Most Mancunians have their own ideas.
A few more greener areas, I think,
yeah.
But so it's a bit more nice when you come in, maybe try and keep the public traffic out more and use the tram system a bit more, I think, yeah.
More leisure activities in the centre, we bring a lot more family entertainment in.
I think it needs something dramatic just to show everyone, including the world, you know, it's not going to faze us.
But with the 60s in mind, how can planners be sure that today's developments don't become tomorrow's nightmares?
We're now 35 years on from the 60s, so
chances are many of the buildings and much of the development was carried out then is now obsolete. The cities change all the time. Cities grow. They change. They always have done. So don't be afraid that there will be a continual process of evolution, and every now and again something will happen which will speed that up. In the 40s it was the aftermath of the war. Today in Manchester it's the aftermath of the bomb.
Meanwhile, the architects with their five models for Manchester in the millennium await their fate.
So the jury's retired, considered and decided, and their verdict on Manchester's future will be delivered tomorrow. It's a decision the city fathers hope will turn this awful devastation into a city centre that will be the envy of Europe. Vernon Mann, News at 10, Manchester.
Now, soccer and struggling Coventry needed an inspired goal from Gary McAllister to earn a point at Everton tonight. Everton scored first through a Graham Stewart penalty just before half-time. Coventry struck back 20 minutes from time when McAllister fired in from the edge of the penalty area. The final score, 1-1. And the main headlines again. President Bill Clinton looks set to win a resounding victory when America goes to the polls tomorrow. And some late news. The president of Pakistan has dismissed Benazir Bhutto's government amid accusations of corruption. The army is said to have surrounded the Punjab parliament buildings and sealed all of Pakistan's airports. And finally, news tonight of the ultimate in home entertainment. It's not a new hi-fi, a widescreen television, or even the latest computer game. It's a real live orchestra, or at least part of one. Robert Hall explains.
The sheer power of an orchestra. But this is an emotional thrill denied to many for whom a visit to a concert hall remains an unattainable dream. Today, one orchestra answered that challenge. At this performance by members of the Royal Philharmonic, everyone is in the front row.
He came across as a sort of strange idea. I don't think it's ever been done before, but an exciting idea. And the whole idea of playing in somebody's bringing the music to people is a fantastic idea.
Dougie, is that follow me in the car?
There's no time for encores. Another full house is waiting. The quartet have performed 5 hours of live music during their dash through Hastings Council Estates. The response, reward enough.
People think, oh yes, we've got, you know, it's for the upper class, but it isn't. It's for everybody.
The kids will hear music that they probably wouldn't normally hear, say, on the radio anyway.
This initiative is part of a wider exercise to open up classical music to an entire community.
Just because you're poor doesn't necessarily mean that you're not interested. A lot of the people we've brought this to today have a considerable amount of interest, but they can't afford live performance.
These new classical music buffs are already booking a repeat performance. Robert Hall, News at 10, East Sussex.
And that is News at 10. I'll be back tomorrow. Till then, good night.
Hello and good evening. We're in for a changeable week of weather. Now that means more in the way of rain and showers, interspersed with some drier intervals, but some strong winds as well. Now the satellite picture shows the last of yesterday's rain clearing the country here, today's shower cloud bubbling up there, and this new area of depression currently over the Atlantic. Now it's that that's going to be bringing more rain to the country later on tomorrow. For tonight, though, we'll see more of these bands of showers crossing the country. There'll be some longer outbreaks of rain, and even some sleet or snow over the Scottish Highlands. A very windy night tonight, though, with gales blowing in the north and west, gusting up to 60 miles an hour in exposed places. A cloudy, dull start to the day for most of us tomorrow, and that's going to bring yet more showers through the course of the morning. At least as we go through the afternoon, though, things will slowly improve, some drier, brighter weather showing up there, some sunshine for some of us. But at the same time, we are going to see that new batch of cloud and rain rolling in from the west across Ireland and into other western parts of Britain towards the evening. A very windy day tomorrow to start off with. The winds will die down a bit later on, but much colder than we've been used to. Top temperatures only 12 Celsius. That's it. Good night.
Sponsored by PowerGen. Producing electricity, whatever the weather.
The consultants take on the medical students in their annual fixture, but who'll take the trophy? Jimmy's. Tuesday at 7:30 on Channel 3 Northeast.
Lego system. Easy to handle pieces. Called Freestyle.
Apple tree elephant. Fisher fly. Doggo plane. Swing house. My friend Horace. Chair garden.
Jack, where have you been keeping yourself? About this commitment thing. You were right. Space is good. I'm in Tahiti.
No ordinary film and camera give you three framing options for consistently brilliant pictures like these and advanced photo developing like this.
So, Jack, the only thing you might want to ask yourself is, who's taking the pictures?
A completely new picture system, Advantix, only from Kodak.
Today, the power to combat backache and rheumatic pain is available without pills. Ibuleve. Only Ibuleve contains the penetrating power of the Ibuleve formula. The power to help conquer backache without pills. The power to relieve rheumatic pain without pills. Even the power to combat non-serious arthritic pain without pills. Ibuleve power from pharmacies. The best-selling gel for pain relief without pills.
You go! By the Longi Dragon.
Dragon on.
The DeLonghi Dragon portable oil-filled radiator. It heats the room faster than any other oil-filled radiator, and it comes with a 5-year guarantee. The DeLonghi Dragon. Extraordinary.
Get a new boiler from British Gas. Pay a 5% deposit and nothing more for 9 months. Call 0345 450 450 now.
I think I'll drive to work today. Mrs. Jones.
Fine. Mr. Jones.
Good morning, Mrs. Jones.
With a Morphy Richards Easy Clean Cool Wall Fryer, there's only one thing easier than cleaning its non-stick removable tank. And its dishwasher-safe lid with permanent filter. And that's the ease with which it cooks great chips. The Morphy Richards range of Easy Clean Cool Wall Fryers guaranteed to make life easy.
This is Tyne Tees on Channel 3 in the Northeast.
Tonight, more calls to ban combat knives after another fatal stabbing. And a mother pleads for help to find her daughter's killer. Good evening. The move to ban sales of combat knives has gained fresh impetus tonight after another fatal stabbing on Tyneside. It was one of four separate knife attacks this weekend in the Northumbria Force area alone. Tonight, after this latest incident, a North East MP has launched a petition to ban the Rambo-style knives.
Police have been making house-to-house inquiries at North Kenton in Newcastle today in their hunt for the two youths who fatally stabbed David Eunice. Mr. Eunice, a 33-year-old electrician from Fordon, died in hospital 5 hours after the attack at midnight on Saturday.
The stabbing in Carsdale Road followed an argument with the two youths after they'd hurled a tin can at Mr. Eunice and his girlfriend Susan Foster. Police say it was a cowardly attack. They've issued a description of one of the youths involved. He had a skinhead haircut with a round baby face and a pale complexion. In Gateshead, Labour MP David Cleland launched a petition calling for a ban on the sale of combat knives. He said there was overwhelming public support for the ban.
I don't think anyone would be under any illusion whatsoever that that is not in any way designed for a domestic purpose.
Meanwhile, two more councils, Newcastle and Gateshead, are set to follow Middlesbrough in banning the sale of combat knives in shops rented from the council.
The mother of a murdered County Durham woman has pleaded for help to catch her daughter's killer. Extra officers have been drafted in to boost the murder hunt.
It's almost a week since 28-year-old Julie Smales was stabbed to death at her home in Ledgate near Consett. But detectives say they're no closer to establishing a motive for her murder. She was last seen alive on the day of her death by her mother, Joy Gilmore. They just spent their usual Tuesday night together.
I loved her so much, and I had the most beautiful relationship with her. Not only as our mother, but we were friends. And she was a beautiful, beautiful person. And I don't believe that she deserved to die like this.
Julie's body was found by firemen who were called to a blaze at her house. She was wearing her night clothes and her hands were tied together. She died from multiple stab wounds, but so far the murder weapon has not been found.
A mother whose 11-year-old daughter was snatched from school by her father 4 days ago has been finding out today exactly where she stands in the eyes of the law. Jennifer Burgess Webster, who's at the centre of a Spanish-English custody battle, disappeared on the way to school in Darlington. Although the past few days have been desperate for Janice Webster, waiting at home for news of her daughter's whereabouts, she's had to keep her spirits up for her 3-year-old son, Eric. The family moved from Spain to County Durham in August, Janice thinking all was well with her ex-husband. But Jennifer was taken away from the school gates by her Spanish father 4 days ago and returned with him to the country where she grew up. Today, Janice has been finding out what legal moves she can make to get her daughter back. But until she's found, there's little she can do. Jennifer phoned her mother from Spain yesterday saying she was safe and staying with her father in the mountains, but that he wouldn't let her say where.
It's not positive for anybody. It's not the right way to do things. Why didn't he go through the legal system?
Over 100 walkers demonstrated today in Hagwood near York against plans to offer it for sale without a public access agreement. Protesters object to the Forestry Commission putting the lease on the open market and the church commissioners who own the shooting rights. Now Labour's environment spokesman Frank Dobson says he'll raise the matter in Parliament.
The Forestry Commission, who leased the 100 acres in the parish of Dunnington, have put it on the market. And the church commissioners, who own the land,